What I'm going to read tonight, I'm going to read for about 15 minutes and then take some questions if there are any. Some real blasts from the past in here as well, which is fun. So I'm going to read for about 15 minutes and take questions. I don't think that I need to tell you terribly much to tee this up. The book sort of follows nine principal characters from right around the fiscal crisis of 75 up through the morning after the blackout of 1977. And in this section, you'll meet one of the characters. You actually meet two of the characters, but the sort of principal character here is Charlie. He's 17 years old. He has two brothers, and at the time that you're going to encounter him, he has just crossed paths a couple months earlier, very briefly, with a girl on a forsaken VFW ball field in his hometown of Flower Hill, Long Island. So now I'm going to read to you from chapter 22. Should really have this bookmarked. All right. Those first few weeks of grief counseling, Charlie took the LIRR in. He was always late, though. Invariably, his train would get hung up in the East River Tunnel. He couldn't tell how much time had passed unless he asked other people. His dad's watch still lay in a coffin-shaped box in his underwear drawer, and they were already looking at him funny because he was doing his nervous humming thing. The stairs only made him more nervous, which led to more humming. And when he came out of the subway, he'd bolt the last five blocks to the doctor's and arrive sweaty and short of breath, sucking on his inhaler. Dr. Altschul must have said something to Mom, because after he got his driver's license in May, she insisted on his taking the station wagon, as she'd insisted on the counseling in the first place. The office was on Charles Street, and the half-basement of a brownstone you wouldn't necessarily have known was anything other than a residence. Even the discreet plaque below the buzzer, "All appointments please ring," made no mention of specialties. This was probably for the peace of mind of clients. Patients? So no one in the waiting room would know what you were there for, who needed board-certified grief counseling, and who needed whatever it was Dr. Altschul's wife, also confusingly named Dr. Altschul, did. Honestly, that Dr. Altschul should be married at all was a mind-bender. He was the kind of bosomy, overweight man who could make even a beard look sexless. Charlie kept trying to memorize the doctor's zippered cardigan so that he could determine at the next session if it was the same one. But as soon as he'd settled in, Dr. Altschul would sort of tip back in his large leather chair and place his hands contentedly on his belly and ask, "So how are we doing this week?" Charlie's own hands stayed tucked under his thighs. "We were doing fine." Which could mean only one thing. Charlie was still in denial. For 8 or 10 weeks now, he'd been resisting the pressure of Dr. Altschul's questions, the Buddha-like invitation of those flattened but not knotted fingers. Charlie focused instead on the oddments of the therapist's desk and walls, diplomas, little carved wood statuettes, intricate patterns woven into the tasseled rug. He'd had the suspicion from the very first that Dr. Altschul, "Bruce," he kept telling Charlie to call him, meant to vacuum out his skull, replace whatever was there with something else. It was connected with the doctor's studious skirting of the word "father" and its equivalents, which of course kept the person they referred to at the very front of Charlie's mind. But suppose they were right, the school guidance counselor, his mom. Suppose the dead father lodged in his skull was making him sick, and suppose Dr. Altschul could pry Dad out like a bad tooth. What then would be left of Charlie? So we talked instead about school and Pee Wee League, about the Sullivans and Ziggy Stardust. When given a homework assignment, think about a moment he'd been scared, he talked about the terrifying dentist his mom used to make him go see on the 38th floor of the Hamilton Sweeney building, how old Dr. DeMoto once scraped his plaque onto a saltine and made him eat it, and how the window, inches away from his chair, gave onto a sheer drop of 600 feet. Mom had this idea that for the finest care, you had to go to Manhattan. In fact, maybe ponying up for a fancy head shrinker now was contrition for Dad. Maybe she thought if he'd been rushed after the second heart attack to a hospital in the city, he'd still be alive. Heights, that's what scares me, Charlie said. And fires, and snakes. One of these wasn't even true. He'd put it in to test Dr. Altschul, or to throw him off the trail. Then one Friday, a month before school ended, he found himself holding forth with unexpected vehemence about Rabbi Lidner. This had been another of his homework assignments, to recover his feelings about his adoption. Abe and Iz will do fine with the Torah study, he said. It's in their blood, but honestly, sometimes I feel sorry for them. They don't know what they're in for. There was a twitch, a resettling of fingers on the cardigan, like a cellist's on his instrument. A movement at the corner of the therapeutic mouth, too quick for the beard to camouflage. What is it you feel they're in for, Charlie? All the stuff about being shepherded, watched over, you and I both know it's bullshit, Doc. If I was any kind of brother, I'd take them aside and tell them. Tell them what? Shall we role play? Charlie let his gaze rest on Dr. Altschul's pantheistic tchotchkes. You know, you are alone, you were alone, you will be alone. This is a worldview you have? I've only been saying this for like 2 months now. What I feel is, basically, you're an alien dropped on a hostile planet whose inhabitants are constantly trying to tempt you into depending on them. Have you seen the man who fell to Earth? Charlie's face was hot, his asthma tightening his throat. I realize that maybe sounds like a metaphor, but you listen to David Bowie, he's thinking about what people will face in the future. I guess I'm trying to, too. Because there's two ways of taking off a Band-Aid. Was it the cardigan he was allergic to? Its lurid flame-stitched pattern seemed to fill the room. And right then, in that moment of weakness, was when the doctor pounced. Charlie, what do you remember about your father? All of Charlie's beautiful rope-a-dope had deserted him. You make it sound like he died 30 years ago. This is what we call an evasion, Charlie. What if I just said, fuck you, would that be an evasion? It makes you angry when I ask about your father? Is our 50 minutes up? We've got another half hour. Charlie resolved to sit there silently with his arms crossed for the remainder of the session, but after a couple of minutes, Dr. Altschul offered to prorate. He seemed to feel a little bad, but probably this too was a ploy. They obviously trained them not to have feelings. As Charlie rose to open the door, the doctor told him that his homework this week was to think about it. A red-haired lady out on the waiting room couch looked up, curious. Think about what? He had an urge to grab the magazine from her hands and rip it in two. Instead, he said something a girl at school had said to him once. Take a picture, it'll last longer. And fled through the narrow basement door, grazing his head on the overhang. It was midday now, the air hotter and stiller than it had been when he went in. The lime-green pelt of pollen on the cars boxing in Mom's wagon let you know they hadn't been driven in a while. Nor had the street been swept. Rotten mulberries from the trees littered the asphalt like dog shit. Charlie kept walking. As the blocks piled up between him and the grief counselor's office, his indignation ripened into something almost like pleasure. Messiness, death, righteous anger, this was Charlie's world. It pleased him that the berries were spoiling and the brownstones were falling apart and the plastic window of a convertible he passed was slashed, wires spilling from its dashboard where the radio had been. It was Dr. Altschul who was the freak, hunkered in his anal little cave, trying to sell Charlie on a world that made sense. It was Dr. Bruce Altschul who was in denial. On Bleecker Street, a speaker out front of a record store blasted Jamaican music. He saw two leather-jacketed boys, one black, one white, loitering inside between deep bins of LPs. Charlie's normal move would have been to hurry past, but but the bright, clear flame of defiance was still lit. Woe betide anyone who tried to fuck with him now. Not that the boys even saw him come in. They were not so much loitering, actually, as pretending to loiter, while a person he hadn't noticed snapped pictures from across the store. Good, she said. That's great. Except, can you try not to look at the camera, dumbass? All it took was the voice. It was her, the girl from the ball field. The hair was different, or maybe it was that the headphones were gone, but her features were still larger than life, the pierced nose, the wide, expressive mouth. He flipped through some nearby records. Quick glances took in more of the boys across the shop. Or men, possibly, in a kind of uniform. Slogans in various hues covered their black jackets, superseded by an identical logo, freshly painted, on the back of each. The white guy's hair was short and uneven, as if cut by lawnmower. The black one wore a stocking cap. The camera would make them look lost in contemplation of the record stacks. Click, click, it went. A devouring sound, or so Charlie imagined. In reality, it was impossible to hear over the deep dish bass thumping off every surface. Then the white one, the giant one, announced he was bored. Are we done yet? Are you kidding? The girl said. You do this like every day, Saul. Yeah, but not in front of a camera. You didn't tell us that would make it be so boring. Plus, Nikki would kill me if he found out. No more cameras, he says. Nikki, 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 the girl said. Why should I listen to someone who refuses to even meet? Only because you never put down the fucking camera. Anyway, I gotta get to work. Fine, whatever, the girl said. I'm out of film anyway. Go screw. But once the guys drifted out the door, she started aiming her lens around at the perfunctory record store crap, the posters on the wall, the smoldering joss sticks, the caged ferret, etc., etc. It landed, eventually, on Charlie. The eye not blocked by the camera opened and then narrowed, as if to bring a memory into focus. Hey, wait a minute, she said. I know you. How do I know you? When he tried to speak, the heavy patchouli odor became a tickle at the back of his throat, leading to a coughing fit, and then wheezing, and ultimately to the inhaler. The VFW field, he managed finally, little tears in the corners of his eyes. You had headphones on, and did the universal sign language for headphones. Oh shit, that's right. What are you doing here, though? He looked over at where the matching jackets had been. What's anybody doing here? He said. Getting the hell off Long Island. Back there in the dugout, the girl had been a school kid, like Charlie. Now she was the emissary of some more adult world. Listen, she said. I've been up since yesterday morning, and I've got to get some caffeine. You want to come with? He wondered if she wasn't hustling him out of the store to spare herself the embarrassment of being seen with him should her friends return. But outside, she stuck out her hand. I'm Sam, by the way. I didn't mean to give you the third degree back there. Jesus, no, he said. It's just weird running into you again like this. Shouldn't you be in school? Shouldn't you? I had a doctor's appointment, he said. Otherwise, my mom wouldn't let me drive in. Right, the bloodhound. I remember. She lit a cigarette. He willed himself not to cough. My dad can be pretty bad, too, she said. But he thinks I had a volleyball tournament last night. All he'd have to do to verify I've never touched a volleyball in my life would be to pick up the phone. But then he'd have to have me around and, like, talk to me, instead of hiding out in his workshop. And anyway, who would want to miss all this? It was true. Greenwich Village on a Friday at lunchtime was the opposite of everything Charlie hated about the suburbs. People everywhere, street musicians, smells of 15 different foods floating out of the propped open doors. In a smoky luncheonette, she led him to a booth by the window and ordered two coffees. The waitress stared at her until Sam said, "What?" "You couldn't order egg salad or something? This is becoming an everyday thing, Sam." "I'll make it worth your while," she said. "Promise." The coffee came in paper cups, as if inviting them to vamoose. But she picked hers up and blew on it and took a drink. Black. "So what's wrong with you?" she said. "Huh?" he said. your doctor's appointment. It's not that kind of doctor. Well, obviously, in this neck of the woods, she said, and if you're driving in by yourself, it's a shrink, right? I meant, are your folks splitting up, or what's the story? My dad, Charlie coughed again. When he'd finished, his voice came out quieter than he meant it to. My dad died in February. Right before I saw you, I guess. Fuck! You should have said something. Are you okay? She said, and put a hand on his hand. His heart almost stopped. I don't want to talk about it. I respect that, she said. Most guys, they just use something like that to get in your pants. Outside, pigeons scrabbled over scraps at the curb. He pretended to like coffee, and after a while, did. You must come here a lot, he said, to know the waitress. After my mom split on us, she said, my dad decided to spring for a fancy school. He admired the casual way she repaid his confidence with the confidence. It's right around the corner. And I started NYU in the fall. I should only be a senior, but I skipped a grade. And your friends, the guys at the record store? She smiled. Saul, the tall one, I know through his girlfriend, who I know from shows. I've been putting together this little, like, magazine thing, trying to document the scene. But it took me 3 months before his friends would let me take photographs. One of them still won't. They can be funny about who they let in. I meant, he said, do they go to school with you? School's not punk, she said. Punk? I can see I'm going to have to educate you, she said. He used a spoon to dredge up the coffee-brown sugar crystals from the bottom of his cup and licked them like a bee harvesting nectar. I'm highly educable. For some reason, it made her laugh. Anyone ever told you you're a charmer, Charlie? He shrugged. No one ever had. Seriously, she said, Saul and those other guys, the post-humanists, their idea of changing the world is just to say no to everything. I don't think you can really change anything unless you're willing to say yes. No, I've already decided. Us Flower Hill kids have to stick together. You're going to be my project. Charlie felt that perhaps there was something not right about this, implying as it did a need for improvement. On the other hand, it was a nice day, he was no longer in the therapist's office, and he had the attention of a beautiful girl. Out on the street again, they dumped their empty coffee cups into an overfull trash can. Charlie wasn't deft enough to avoid bringing a whole mortifying mound of soda bottles and newspapers and styrofoam takeout containers crashing down around his hush puppies. But Sam just laughed again, and it wasn't the kind of laughter that subtracted anything. It was a warm breeze lifting him up. Then Sam was planting her fingers around Charlie's shoulder blades and propelling him back through the door of the record store. The register was on a raised platform near the back. The bear-like clerk, too, seemed to know Sam, for he nodded at her from on high. Charlie drifted over to the bees and began to flip through ba, be, bi, bo. The Bowie selection was impressive, at least compared to the cruddy little strip mall storefront he was used to. There was a colored vinyl single of Suffragette City and an expensive live recording with a sticker that said Import. He wanted to look at it more closely, but as soon as he saw Sam coming, he put the record back in its place and reached for another tab at random. George Benson, she said? Yikes! What? No, I was just goofing around. Well, here's your first mission, should you choose to accept it. She handed him a 45. There was a turntable near the register where you could listen to records pre-purchase. Sam placed the headphones on Charlie's head, a weirdly intimate gesture, and queued up the B-side and watched his face while he listened. At first, he thought there was something wrong with the headphones. The music was a distant tempest of revved-up drums and guitars. But when the instruments locked up and the chanting started, he understood it was a style. Amateur, noisy, aggressive. It was anger heated to the boiling point where it became a sort of joy. The very feeling Charlie had felt this morning, storming out of the doctor's office. When he looked up, Sam's mouth was moving. He took off the headphones. What? Amazing, right? It is amazing, he said. But I don't have any money. I'll buy it for you, she said. I can't let you do that. Sure you can, she said. Anyway, I owe you. For what? He said. You said you had a car, right? You're driving me home.
Thank you.
And now I am happy, if not obligated, to take any questions or comments or whatever you guys might want to throw at me, if any.
What? I love the book, by the way. Whoa, this is loud. I thought the book was amazing. I finished it a couple weeks ago, so I thought it was tremendous. So congratulations on everything. And I had the weird sensation of, coincidentally, while I was reading your book, I was listening when I was going to the subway things, I was listening to The Bonfire of the Vanities on audiobook. So I had this strange coincidental thing of going back and forth between 70s and 80s New York City. And I was struck by actually how much more ambitious your book is than Tom Wolfe's book. And I just wanted to ask you, in terms of setting, you know, why 1977? Was that a conscious choice to do a book set in the 70s? And why, or if, did you start with a character and then try to place them into the 70s? I guess I'm just questioning the genesis of the book.
Well, it sounds like you experienced some kind of strange synchronicity, and it's not that surprising to me to hear that, because my experience of this book has sort of been one of like much synchronicity. So it actually kind of all came as a piece almost, although it was fused. Like, you know, the way they say the universe, you know, at 0.00001 microseconds after the Big Bang, you know, space, time, and matter and energy are all sort of just one thing. But it all kind of came, you know, in this very solid, fused form in the space of about 45 seconds in the summer of 2003. And, you know, the setting, both place and time, were inextricable from all the other things that were bound up with it. But part of what was incredibly compelling to me about the time period, apart from the fact that I'd sort of been daydreaming my way into it since I was a, you know, outrageously disaffected youth driving around the back roads in North Carolina, or like driving to Knoxville to see Paige, like smoking cigarettes and listening to Patti Smith. You know, I'd sort of like been just, I don't know, imaginatively thinking about this time for some reason. But when it returned to me in the form of the book, part of what seemed incredibly compelling was that in it, I could see in sort of heightened, more vivid, more exaggerated, more naked form, so many of the conflicts that I felt we were living through in late 2001 and 2002 and 2003. That is, a city on the precipice, suspended, this is a Matthew Arnold line, stranded between two worlds, one dying and one yet to be born. And my experience of like growing up in the 90s was essentially, you know, just the end of history, I think, in the phrase, like, you know, everybody's just gonna, you know, invest in mutual funds and like work for .coms and like, you know, the Cold War's over and nothing's really gonna happen. And like the first sort of event of my adult life was September 11th. I was in Washington, D.C. at the time, but I'd been trying to get to New York for 5 years. And all of a sudden, you know, exposed at that moment was this whole, you know, concatenation of things having to do with security and safety and order on one hand versus freedom and risk and danger on the other hand. And that is not to endorse the primacy of one over the other. You know, you can't build your entire life around constantly, you know, risky behavior or you will die. But you know, you obviously, you know, a world of perfect order and perfect safety is a world in which you might as well already be dead. And so in the sort of aftermath of 2001, you know, I had this feeling of like, you know, suddenly these kind of like tensions between these things were exposed, and people were talking about them and thinking about them and living them and asking real deep questions about, like, you know, what are we going to do with ourselves nationally or personally? Like, I quit my job and went to go teach elementary school because I was so, I mean, it was a near-death experience nationally. And I thought that those tensions were incredibly and eloquently present in this particular time period. And so it seemed to me to be a way of, it seemed to be a channel through which everything that I was thinking about now wanted to express itself. And then the financial crisis came along later, echoing the sort of fiscal crisis. And, you know, you do a little research and there's terrorist groups running around in the 70s in the city. You know, there's a bomb going off over here on 13th Street. That was a little earlier, but not by much. And just the echoes seemed to me powerful and resonant and uncanny.
Thank you, and congratulations for your book. You know, I'm not American, as you might hear. I was just wondering, like, you dedicate your book to the New York in the 70s, but does that mean that today's New York is like less interesting, is like less worthy of a book, to like gentrify, to save, less Romanesque than New York was in the 70s?
I don't think less interesting, certainly not. I mean, you know, I have a five-year-old at home, and whenever he's like, I'm bored, I'm like, I trot out the old, you know, there's no boring things, only boring people, don't be a boring person. But, I mean, I would stress that it did not present itself to me as a choice that I was making to set the book at the time. It was just like, that's when this book is set. And everything is sort of baked into that. In the same way that it wasn't like, you know, I had a map on the wall and was going, Cleveland, St. Louis, New York, eeny, meeny, miny. It was just, you know, that's what it was. But I do think, you know, as I started to think about, you know, the insanity of writing, you know, spending 6 years of my life writing an unpublishable project about a time and a place that I did not live, I started noticing that many of the books that were touchstones for me, long novels from the 19th century, were also set 30 years in the past. So War and Peace's war is the Napoleonic War, which is not Tolstoy's war. The Chancery Courts in Bleak House did not exist. It had long been abolished at the time that Bleak House came along and used them as a sort of MacGuffin. The debtor's prison in Little Dorrit, the land reforms that are sort of kind of in and around Middlemarch. Those are all things that were 30 years. And I do think there's this thing, you know, I don't know how many people have read the Dennis Johnson book, Tree of Smoke, which is set in Vietnam, but it's the great sort of Iraq War novel. And there's something about having a place to stand. I mean, Archimedes said, give me a place to stand. You know, it's not just having the lever, but you have to have a place to stand to move the whole world. And that place can't be on the world, or you're trying to lever what you're standing on. And so I think having a kind of, I don't know, I think it offered a kind of perspective that I wouldn't necessarily have if I was writing about today's New York. So if I was writing about today's New York, I think I would sort of write in like a stream of consciousness of tweets. You know what I mean? And that sounds like that could be either a good book or a terrible book. I mean, I think this is something the Ben Lerner book kind of wrestles with in an interesting way, 1004. I think the wrestling is very visible in the book. I happen to like the book and think the book is successful, but you can feel the way that the perspective is limited by the fact that, you know, he's standing on the world. He's trying to lever. And in this case, what seemed radical to me, sort of bizarrely, was to attempt to achieve some sort of, you know, synthesis of perspective and actually try to, you know, get my arms around the whole damn thing.
I just have one other question. You know, I don't want to be like embarrassing, you know. But
well, careful what question you choose then.
I'm so sorry, but because I'm like a journalist as well, that's why, you know. And you know, like, an America is a country of capitalism, you know, even though like Bernie Sanders say otherwise. But I was just wondering, like, does like sorry to say to Alexas, you know, but does your book deal is like paralyzing for like a young writer as you are, you know? Does the fact to get like good book deal, even like a record one, you know, is like paralyzing on you for your like inspiration or for your writing, you know? And even for the expectation you can have about your amazing book.
I wouldn't be much of a writer if I, you know, went to the desk and sat down and spent a lot of time thinking about that stuff. So part of what kind of the experience of, so Paige here and I, you know, we're teenagers together, kind of on, and Jen, who I haven't seen in like, you know, a quarter of a century. We're all very long in the tooth. But we were sort of teenagers together in and on the periphery of, you know, punk music in the 90s and the kind of like some incredibly vital punk scenes. There, you know, and there was like a vital hardcore scene in New York, but it was not the kind of, New York was not the like molten white hot center of punk the way that it had been in 77. Someone in here is like an ABC No Rio person's gonna kill me for saying this, but like DC, you know, which is a punk scene that I spent some time on the fringes of, was sort of still incredibly potent in shaping consciousness, in 1995, and also, you know, Riot Girl, which was sort of overlapping with the DC scene, and that really formed me in a lot of ways as a person. It ruined me for shopping, as my wife can tell you. Like, you know, if the shoes don't have holes in them, they don't need to be replaced. You know, it's just, so it's not, you know, I learned at a, you know, I was at a very vulnerable moment. And the characters in the book, Sam, who you just met, is like at this moment. And suddenly coming into contact with someone who affirms, it's not what you're consuming. It's not what you're selling, it's what you're buying. It's the Fugazi line, but it's not what you're consuming, it's what you're making that matters. And, you know, in doing the book, you know, the 3 years of the first draft during which I labored under the conviction that this was an unpublishable project by virtue of its scope and insanity and the fact that I was a nobody, affirmed in me some very deep apprehensions that I had imbibed about art and how to go about making it. And it just, not to be sort of glib about this, but it would take a lot more to like compromise that than, you know, just some business stuff that really doesn't have anything to do with me. Any others?
So I just got this tonight, so I have not read it. But I'm curious, you know, you were talking about the process, and I apologize if everyone here already knows this from the reviews, et cetera, but how, so you said 6 years it took, 3 years was the first draft. Like, how did you have the arc of the story and then had to go in and fill in all the research, or how did it kind of come together?
So I had this, you know, the kind of initial supernova of the book was in 2003. And I sat down and I wrote a scene, and it scared me so badly, because it was just, there were levels of like intensity and velocity that I was at 24 just clearly ill-equipped to keep up with. And also, to be honest, I mean, at that point, I think I didn't realize yet that what scares you when you're making art is the thing that you should be going toward. Like, the fear is an indication that you're on the right track, and that it's not supposed to feel, you know, safe and like, whee! So I put it away. I wrote this scene, and I was like, I can't. I don't have the chops to do this, and I'm going to ruin it if I keep going. But I know that this book will be written and must be written by me, and probably that no one will ever read it. So I'm going to put this away, and maybe I'll come back to it in 10 years when I don't know, when I can do it justice, when it doesn't make me feel like my hand's going to melt, you know, writing it. And during the time I put it away, I mean, I wrote short stories and various things, and did a lot of, you know, was kind of new to the city. I did a lot of wandering, a lot of aimless wandering, trying to, you know, my wife, you know, was like, it's work. It's, I'm really working. You know, it looks like I'm doing nothing, but I promise. This is serious, things are going on in here. And when I came back to it in 2007, one of the things that had happened was that the universe, the fictional universe, had continued to just expand beneath my notice, as it were. Like, and everything, every little, I suffer, among the various reasons that I am completely unfit for any other kind of work and can't even keep my shoelaces tied, is I have like an inability to like discard, you know, like immediately irrelevant information. Like I hang on to everything because it might be useful, you never know. And all these little, and like I hear things in music even, like little things that just come from like the way the guitar sound almost, that tell me something about the way the room is and the way the light is in it. Or like if you ever listen to Perfect Day by Lou Reed, sometimes Hemingway talks about the fact that you don't need, there are ways of communicating what color the dog is without naming the color of the dog. And when I listen to Perfect Day by Lou Reed, I know every freaking thing, like the whole cinematic thing about it. And you do too. You know, I don't think he specifies a month, but you know it's late October, early November, just from the way the piano sounds, you know? And all those little details, all those little things had like accreted and joined this fictional world. So I come back to it in 2007, and it was like opening up a door, you know, opening the wardrobe and walking into Narnia. It was just very fully formed. And I knew somehow, I felt that I knew somehow that I had it right in the weirdest possible way. And I really can't account for that. It's an utter mystery to me, but I was like, I know I have this right. I know this place and I know this time. And so it was incredibly kind of a gut check moment when the first people who had actually been around in New York in the 70s read it, and I was like, oh boy, like I really hope I had this right. But I had to, in 2007, I had to trust it. And so I started, you know, I opened up a computer file, because I was pretty platform agnostic at that point. And I was also like a little bit, it was like kind of a moment of personal desperation. And I started writing, and the fact that the world had sort of, you know, continued to expand was great, but also in practical terms very daunting, and I would feel very overwhelmed, I think, for like the first 5 or 7 days, by like, I don't know, you know, I know this character's on this roof looking south at this time, I just see it, I know that that's real, and I know that, you know, in this other moment, he's sitting on the bumper of a car looking up at the lit windows of a building on Central Park West. But how he gets from one to the other and who it is that's walking through the door behind him on that rooftop, I've got to find out. I've got a right to find out. So I eventually was like, screw this. And I got some gridded art notebooks that I'd, you know, seen friends who are designers writing in with their arty little designer, you know, handwriting. And somehow the boxes, I think, immediately were like, oh, because all of a sudden it was just letters. I was like, all I have to do is fill this one little box, one box at a time. And I started writing longhand and really haven't gone back from that. So they did the whole first draft longhand. And I went, you know, the sections of the book are divided by these sort of interludes, and one notebook would be about one section of the book, and then I'd go back and I'd type it up, and I would kind of make notes in the margins, like go back and change ham sandwich to banana, you know, continuity error, or like what if, you know, this person pulls a knife on this other person 500 pages from now or something. But I just kind of worked like that, and you know, I would go back and edit as I typed, you know, so the typing was itself kind of doing another draft, and then I'd move on. But then I got this idea. I didn't want to research ahead of time, because I didn't want to, like, I like Bonfire of the Vanities, but there's sometimes with Tom Wolfe, especially in fiction, you can feel that he's like, you know, he's straining to put in a piece of research that is so good he just doesn't want to let go of, but it doesn't fit in the fiction. And I knew that if I tried to research my way to authenticity, you know, rather than just doing it on like crazy moxie, that it wasn't going to work. But after I had finished typing up a section, I realized then I could go back and sort of fact check and maybe stumble into some, you know, keep my antennas up, and maybe I'd stumble into something that might come useful down the road. So I went to the New York Public Library and I met this gentleman, David Smith, in the back. And I said, "Can you help me?" And he said, "I can." So he set me up in a room in the library with a shelf. And I mean, every other shelf in the library, you get a little shelf and you get to keep your books there. You don't have to send them back to the stacks at night. And every other shelf, you could walk around and sort of be like, yes, dissertation on Nietzsche. Or like, evolutionary biology. You would look at my shelf and we'd be like, this guy has no idea how to do research. It was just very esoteric and syncretic, but it felt great. I was like, yes, a novelist should have no idea how to do research. I got that from E.L. Doctorow, by the way. He was, people were like, "How much research did you do for Ragtime?" He'd be like, just enough to fool you. And I did read, I sort of read a lot of facsimiles of the newspaper. You know, I found one of the databases will show you ProQuest historical newspapers, David. Yeah, they're getting thumbs up. Which you could see the, you know, the actual facsimile of the pages of the Times. And I would just go back. I mean, I think I did this for 2 summers. You're supposed to kick me out after 3 months, but I was there for like 18 months or 2 years, you know, just keeping the shelf and going there in the afternoon to like mess around. And I would, you know, if it was June 18th, I'd be like, let me read the paper for June 18th, 1976. I'll spend an hour doing that. The ads are incredible. You know, the words like jacquard loomed, you know, wool. I was like, yeah. The little juxtaposition of things, crazy letters to the editor. I mean, the textures were what I was like really after. And I would also buttonhole people who had been around in the blackout. And without telling them that I was kind of like recording them, as it were, with my mind, I would sort of like artificially steer the conversation. You know, "I like those shoes. Those are black. I know those are black. Has there been another time in New York when you've been faced with intense blackness? And can you tell me what happened?" And everyone had a blackout story. I mean, everyone remembers this thing. And this is before, you know, the technology came along to make everything a shared experience. Like, you know, Kim Kardashian is a shared experience now. But like, at that time, this was like a rare thing that every single person was like, "I know exactly where I was, I know exactly what I was doing." And it was always crazy. And sometimes it would be like crazy, you know, benignly crazy. Like, I was in a restaurant and they, you know, gave us all free wine and we pulled the tables out to the... Then other times it would be crazy, crazy. Like, someone pulled out a gun and started shooting at the ceiling. And I, because I knew I was going to go to the blackout eventually.
I have another question, because if I recall well, in your book, one of the main characters is a black man, right? And I was wondering, like, as a white writer, like, how does it feel to write about like a black character? Is it like writing about like a white character, or is it like a legitimacy issue or something like that need to be solved or not?
Need it, like, the ability to solve it would presuppose that I was in some position to judge the success of it, which I'm not. So what it felt like was a risk. But as I said, at the time when I came back to the work, I was chasing risk. And one of the things that would have seemed to me to be a real legitimacy issue is to write a novel of this size populated entirely by white men between the ages of 27 and 32. Boring! And I mean, and I'm being a little, you know, I'm kind of skating on the surface. To get a little bit deeper, I mean, the novel is deeply, deeply interested in the question of whether and how it is possible to know other people. It is an empirical fact that, you know, you are stuck with the body you've got. But it is also, if you, you know, define empirically slightly different, an empirical fact that we often have the experience of sitting across the table from someone, having a beer, and really feeling like we are partway in their head, and then the next sentence that comes out of their mouth, you knew they were going to say that. So you're sharing something. So it's like, you know, the other person, you know, the other is like the philosophical thing, is it's neither inaccessible nor completely accessible. It's like difference is neither, you know, it doesn't just go away. You can't think it away. And yet it's also demonstrably can't be this insurmountable gap, particularly for, you know, if you believe, as I do, in the metropolitan ideal of a bunch of people. It's kind of like a big fractious family, like a bunch of people who should basically not be able to function together, somehow managing to get together and make this puppy work, which was one of the things that I felt was really under assault, you know, in 2001. I mean, there's all of this argument for control of the narrative, like what was under attack, what was going to be lost. And one of the signal ironies to me was that one of the narratives in its solution seemed to push toward eliminating the very thing that was worth protecting, which was, you know, openness to the other. And so Mercer is no less me than Charlie is, in a way. And yet, you know, I know what I don't know about Mercer. You know, it's complicated. It's a mystery, you know, but I wanted to write into the mystery and I wanted to write into the risk.
The other irony there is that after 9/11, we drove other people away, whereas during 9/11, the whole city, you know, got together, and you never saw a city stronger, you know, or happier. Not happy, but you know what I mean. Working together.
I know
together.
Exactly what you mean.
And it was the same thing when the blackout occurred, when people were taking to the streets and directing traffic and helping the old lady across the hall, you know, who didn't have food and stuff like that.
These events, like, bring out, you know, everything that is best and everything that is worst in human nature, which is also, if you think about it, like what some novels want to do as well.
So when you wrote this book, when you started in 2003, you had to be fearless. On the other hand, when you ain't got nothing, you got nothing to lose. Now it's a different story. And I haven't read the book yet, but like everybody I know, all the praise that it's gotten and all the incredible attention, whether you're on an airplane or whatever, it's like the recommended book. You have to check this out. My wife's...
You cannot leave this plane unless you check this book out.
Exactly.
Thank you, Knopf Publicity.
Exactly. But any magazine you pick up, you know, it'll be like that. Does the ball game change as far as fearlessness goes with the next one, or does the whole... for you art thing kick in, so it's just going to be you and Virginia Woolf in the ring?
I mean I don't know. I mean, I guess it depends on how much of an artist I actually turn out to be, which will only be, I mean, verdict to be rendered upon death, you know. I presume, you know, I mean, I think about the characters in this book who are, you know, looking at this destroyed kind of landscape, or inhabiting a ruin almost, and not having anything, and deciding, you know, I need to make a record, or I need to make a song. I think about like Patti Smith, who clerked here for a while, you know, and then would run off with the other clerks bitching about, you know, her presumption in doing so, to go give a poetry reading on like the roof of a building over on East 8th Street or something. And just like making, you know, into like singing into the void, you know. And that's the feeling that, I don't know. It's not really, you know, I'm just hypothesizing, but I feel that that's the feeling that a lot of the artists who mean a lot to me are chasing, and that's the feeling that I'm chasing. So I don't, you know, I don't know what the hell's going on out there. I'm not reading the press. Like, I don't know. It's been like a very quiet week for me. I'm just waking up, like, you know, doing my work. And
well, she's still someone to aspire to, because she is the ultimate fearless artist.
Yeah, I mean, I agree, and actually, this is kind of fun. She's in the book. And also, I love the permissions page at the back. This is also fun. Like every other song lyric is like, you know, we're being recorded. Is the virtuous Hal Leonard Corporation, you know, permission of 15 different people who have the rights to the song, and then it's like Patti Smith lyrics. Reprinted by permission of Patti Smith. And I'm like, creative control. That's a beautiful thing.
We have time for one more question. All right.
I always find it really interesting when authors share what authors and books have really impacted them. And I was wondering if you could talk about some of the thinkers, authors, and books that have really shaped you in ways that you can draw upon, but in maybe in other ways that sort of just loosely have influenced you.
How much time do we have? I have taught fiction writing in various tenuous adjunct perches around the city, most of the writing of this, like I was teaching like four classes and pouring coffee and like raising children. It's crazy. But, and I would have students who would be like, I don't know, I'm afraid to read anything while I'm working. And I'm just kind of like, influence me, save me from the disaster of my own writing. So, DeLillo is big for me. Infinite Jest was big for me. Mrs. Dalloway was big for me. Bellow is big for me. Deborah Eisenberg is very big for me. Norman Rush. Dickens. Joyce. Edith Wharton. George Eliot for being good at all of it. Like, you know, there are things at which she is not the best, but there is nothing that she's not really freaking good at. So the books are like, they're novels of ideas. They're interestingly plotted and suspenseful. You get deep inside the characters and you care about them. They're filled with like aphoristic intelligence. They're beautifully written. I mean, she's sort of like, the dialogue's good. It's like, they're all sort of, especially Middlemarch, you know, hitting on all cylinders. She just doesn't, you know, she does it all. I love that. And then I am a really like amateurish, I'm like maybe worse of a reader of philosophy than I am a historian. Like if there's one thing that is more haphazard and ridiculous than my research, it is my willful misreading of of philosophy. But I did, I read this book by, not, I'm going to get it wrong, Douglas Hofstadter, not Richard Hofstadter. There's two Hofstadters, but it's called Gödel, Escherbach, An Eternal Golden Braid. It's a really trippy, crazy book about consciousness and computer science and systems theory and whatever. I got really into like systems theory, which was called cybernetics at this like kind of eclipsed moment in the 60s and 70s, which sounds like it's about computers, but it's really about ecology and how everything fits together and the crazy dance of like interdependent variables, you know, required to make organic life. And it seemed to me to have a lot to say about novels. Whitman, you know, poets, like I can't read prose before I write in the morning. Or I, you know, if I sneak in, like if I so much as glance at like the copy on a Cheerios box, like it kind of screws me up. But poetry, you know, is something that I can really read. I was reading a lot of Berryman, a lot of Whitman, Emily Dickinson, all of it, all of the above. That's why I functionally lived in the Strand for a few years after first. I didn't realize, it's like Disney World, and you're like, I want to ride all the rides when you first get there, and you don't realize you can't ride all the rides. You just can't. There's too many. It's 8 miles of books. So
it's 18 now.
It's 18 freaking miles of books.
All right. Well, that's a great stopping place. Thank you so much for being here with us tonight. We're going to take some time to do some signing. So if you do have a copy of the book, we're going to have him up here at this table. If we can start a line and kind of work its way around the chairs here. And if you haven't had a chance to purchase, please feel free. There's several copies at the register. And thank you all so much for being here tonight.
Thank you.